community, and we're just blessed to be here in the house of the Lord, and we're blessed to be together to worship. We do want to, in the midst of our greeting, to give you one reminder that next Sunday we won't meet here at the church. We're planning to meet at Rushville Park at 11 o'clock for morning worship, and at the end of that, a bag lunch will be provided so that you can have some fellowship. We will sort of space ourselves out as we normally would do. But we'll have a good time, and hopefully we'll have some more folks that will come out and join us for this time together, just to be a little different and to have a little different opportunity to be with one another. So put that in your calendar. If you haven't already seen the either, you should have got a letter or an email that did highlight that a little bit as well. So let us begin our time of worship. And as we do offer these words for worship for you in this morning. Come, all who thirst, come to the water. For you who long for the water of life, come and drink. Dip your soul in the river of God's goodness. Quench your thirst at God's well of grace. For God is here among us, offering living water to all who would drink. Let's worship God together. At this time, let us enter into a time of prayer. In the dry wilderness of our lives, in the days of heat and thirst, you offer us living water. Thank you, gracious and generous God. When we begin to doubt your presence and grumble that your love is unreliable, you offer us living water. Thank you, gracious and generous God. When life's regrets and the bad choices we have made leave us feeling excluded and unworthy, you offer us living water. Thank you, gracious and generous God. When circumstances or the inhumanity of others have left us alone and wounded, you offer us living water. Thank you, gracious and generous God. We thank you and praise you, O God, that however we may thirst, whatever we may need to satisfy our souls, you offer it freely and abundantly in Christ. So we drink deep of the living water, and as we draw from your wells, we seek to pass the cup to others who, like us, are thirsty for your grace. Amen. Gifts in a uniquely different way than what we have normally gifts being sent through the mail or brought to the church and just received at the back of the sanctuary. But it does give us opportunity to share in what God has given to us, what God has blessed us with, so that we may bless the ministries of this church in these very unique days that we have, that we still are able to be with one another at times, and where we're not able to be with one another in the sanctuary, we are gathered together in the communities of our home, or maybe even a place of vacation, or whatever it might be, that we can still worship together. But giftedness comes not only through our financial sharing and gifts. It comes through the work that we do as we share in our talents. But most of all, as we give of our time and our presence in this place and to the church. Scripture always says that God loves the cheerful giver. We give cheerfully, no matter where we find ourselves and when we gather. As we ponder upon our willingness to give the things that we might share with God, let us spend a few moments in reflection. We hear your call to generous giving in the way you meet our needs each day and in the peace you give which passes understanding. Having received so much, we offer all we have, our time, talents, and money for your kingdom. Bless these gifts for the work of your church. Amen. We're going to offer two scriptures today, and I've told Nathan to keep up because I think there's on a few different slides here as we do this together. The first one should be easy. It's a couple of them. It's Psalm 78, 1 through 4. Then we'll go to verses 12 to 16. Following that, it will be Exodus chapter 17, verses 1 through 7. Let us hear these words. From the Psalms, we read this. My friends, I beg you to listen as I teach. I will give instruction and explain the mystery of what happened long ago. These things we learned from our ancestors, and we will tell them to the next generation. We won't keep secret the glorious deeds and the mighty miracles of the Lord. Starting in verse 12, He did for their ancestors near Zoan in Egypt. God made a path in the sea and piled up the water as He led them across. He guided them during the day with a cloud, and each night He led them with a flaming fire. God made water flow from rocks He split open in the desert, and His people drank freely as though from a lake. He made streams gush out like rivers from rocks. And from the book of Exodus, chapter 17, verses 1 through 7. The Israelites left the desert and moved from one place to another each time the Lord ordered them to. And once they camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for them to drink. The people started complaining to Moses, "Give us some water." Moses replied, "Why are you complaining to me and trying to put the Lord to the test?" But the people were thirsty and kept on complaining, "Moses, did you bring us out of Egypt just to let us and our families and our animals die of thirst?" Then Moses prayed to the Lord, "What am I going to do with these people? They are about to stone me to death." The Lord answered, take some of the leaders with you and go ahead of the rest of the people, and take along the walking stick you used to strike the Nile River. And when you get to the rock at Mount Sinai, I will be there with you. Strike the rock with a stick, and water will be poured out for the people to drink. Moses did this while the leaders watched. The people complained and tested the Lord by asking, is the Lord really with us? So Moses named the place Massah, which means testing, and Meribah, which means complaining. May we be blessed with the reading of God's word. We enter into a time of prayer. We give you a chance to offer any prayer concerns that you might have or any joys that you would like to share in this time. Forest fire, yes. Others? Just for the joy of being here today, I think it's a very wonderful blessing. We can continue to be together as the people of God. Are there any solid prayer requests you'd just like to raise your hand? Joys? As we enter to a time of prayer, we will give you a time of silence for you to pray, for you to share your joy, for you to share your concern with God in this time. Let us take time out. God, there's a wonderful hymn that reminds us to be silent, be silent. We hear those words and we might in some sense be anxious about it or intimidated by silence, but silence is what is good sometimes. And hymns to remind us that when we are silent, we can truly hear you. That we can hear you in the midst of all the other noise that might be around us. Because too often that's all our lives are filled with is noise. Noise that may inundate us in our places of work, in our places of learning, in our places that we shop, in the car where we ride, and many times even in our own homes. Very little time is there silence in our lives. And so we take just a few moments in this morning, as we just did, to kind of silently lift up our own prayers to you. We have some who have spoken and shared. I mean, we're remembering those who are busy in their life fighting fires to protect others, protect life, protect property. We remember those who are doing their diligent duties to do that in other respects. We're mindful of the joys that you provide for us in this day, the day that we can come out into your house and to worship you. And maybe we're not quite settled yet to be able to feel comfortable enough to come out into this place, but we might be watching on our laptops or our phones, or maybe we have our laptops or our phones connected to our TV so that we can watch the service and enjoy what you provide for us. Words of comfort, words that encourage, words that offer hope and meaning, words that express love, not only to one another, but to you, God. And those words come through prayers, those words come through scripture, and those words come through song, that we might offer these to you. We talk about in our time of giving that it's about time, talent, and resources, our money, but it's also about just what we can offer you in a sense of listening, of being silent, of sharing in song together. Worship comes in so many forms, God, and we're so glad to be able to offer these things to you. So continue to be with us in this joyous occasion and in this day. For the joys of that people might be experiencing in this moment, but also we want to lift up the concerns upon our hearts. Persons that we're mindful of who might be sick, who might not be feeling very well. Those who have been in the hospital or those that might be. Those that are experiencing grief or are still experiencing what grief has caused. We offer comfort and encouragement to each one. We offer healing and peace. God, we give you thanks for this day that you provided for us, and we give you thanks for all that you do. It's a blessing to be here and a blessing to be in your presence. And in this we give you thanks. For it's in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Little story says this. It says an angel appears at a faculty meeting and tells the dean, in return for your unselfish exemplary behavior, the Lord will reward you with your choice of infinite wealth, wisdom, or beauty. Give me the wisdom, declares the dean without hesitation. Done, says the angel, before disappearing in a cloud of smoke. All the heads now turn to the dean, who sits surrounded by a faint halo of light. Well, says a colleague, say something brilliant. To which the dean stands and with the poise of Socrates quotes, opines, I should have taken the money. Yep, that was a wise thing to do, wasn't it? I like this picture, and we'll talk about it in a little bit. I like the pictures I've been able to find and put up on the screen because they highlight a little bit of what our theme is, or at least part of the story. As you can see, Moses, at least an illustration of Moses, striking the rock and the water comes out. The gospel writer John quotes Jesus as telling the people once, if you are thirsty, come to me and drink. Have faith in me, and you will have life-giving water flowing from deep inside you, just as the scriptures say. You know, Jesus knew the importance of water, for water is an important resource for crops and for animals, key economic commodities of the day and today as well. It helped with their growth, their health, and their sustainability. For without it, things would perish, which meant that the people he was teaching would perish also. For water, he knew, was also an important resource for people. It is life-giving, and that it keeps the body from being dehydrated. And well, it quenches thirst, giving refreshment in the dry, arid air of the Middle East. And it was a source of cooling for hot, tired bodies, and especially feet, when we think about the feet washing. You know, for four of them, it was a valuable resource for their own life of work that they were called away from. Fishermen, who relied on waters of the sea for fish, an economic commodity of the day as well. Scripture even talks about Jesus, who walked on the water to teach his disciples a valuable lesson about having faith. Water was and still is necessary for life. Plant life, animals, and people. And water itself is living, in that it's full of these microscopic organisms that exist for other creatures to survive. These organisms that may cause us to get sick, but as water is purified, it loses these things so it becomes good for us to drink. Water is good for our health, for our energy, and even for weight loss. There are so many benefits that water offers us if we just drink the necessary amount. But as we'll reflect on later, the water Jesus was offering was much different than this water that we drink. The water of the people of Moses. The people of Israel, as they had been in the wilderness after leaving Egypt, grew frustrated at the lack of water that they had and demanded that Moses give them water to drink. Scripture says they left the desert and moved from one place to another. Each time the Lord ordered them to. And one time when they were camping, there was no water for them to drink. So who did they start to complain to? They complained to Moses, saying, "Give us some water." Now, I'm not sure at this moment where Moses was supposed to give them water from. He might not have had a water bag. He didn't have this tank following him of water that they could drink from. But Moses was their leader, wasn't he? And he was the one they went to. To which Moses replied, "Why are you complaining to me?" And trying to put the Lord to the test. I'm sure Moses had had enough of people at times. And in a way, though, it looks like Moses decides to throw God under the bus, doesn't he? Moses is not taking the responsibility for this. He wonders aloud at the real motives of the people to put God to the test. What can God do for us in this moment? And you have an audience with him more than we do. So you go talk to him. Why are we out here if we can't have water? Remember, they have had their up and down moments many times, haven't they? Thanking God one minute and complaining the next. And Moses is the one that always has to listen to their grumbling. I mean, in a sense, who are they really blaming? The one they can't see or the one they can see? Who are they blaming, Moses or God? A little of both, aren't they? But they blame Moses because they can see him. He's there. He's the figurehead. He's the one leading them through this. When in some ways they were also complaining to God. But they were not giving into Moses' argument and to be pondering their own demise in the wilderness at the hands of Moses. It says that they kept complaining because they were thirsty. "Moses, did you bring us out of Egypt just to let us and our families and our animals die of thirst?" We've heard this before, haven't we? Remember the Red Sea? As they got there to the Red Sea, what was the first thing they said? "Did you bring us down here so that the Egyptians can kill us?" These people had not seen enough of what God could do, and God had done plenty. But it reminds us of us. As we see the stories of Jesus, We hear and see what Jesus can do. We see with the disciples how they kind of, at times, still didn't have faith in Jesus. And they had a hard time believing in Him and what He can do. Even in the midst of all the miracles He performed, the blind people who began to see, the deaf who could hear, those who had limbs that did not work, all of a sudden could walk or move, and even the dead could be brought back to life. But still, people had a hard time, many times, believing. Do we? So Moses, it says, went to God. After all, it was God who gave Moses the responsibility for these people, liberating them from Egypt and taking them into the wilderness, trusting God to lead them to the promised land. So when we are in times of need, in desperation, in times of trouble, who do we go to? When things are uncertain, when we feel pain, when we feel fear, we're discomforted, who do we go to? We go to God, don't we? We get on our knees and we pray. We say, God, help me in these moments. And that's what Moses did. Although Moses gives this little complaining caveat in it as well. What am I going to do with these people? Moses says. For they are about to stone me to death. Already to say was, God, what should I do in this moment? But in a sense, Moses is also complaining, isn't he? Moses is taking the frustrations and the complaints and the grumbling on the people that he's experiencing, and all of a sudden he puts it on God. God, they're going to kill me if I don't do something about this. No, God, they're going to stone me if you don't do something about this. But God brought the people out here for a reason. God liberated the people from Egypt for a reason, did He not? He heard their prayers that they expressed in Egypt, saying, free us, God, free us from this life. And God was going to take them to this promised land no matter what. He wasn't going to leave them in this desert to die, was He? Now some will. Moses will not make it. But God had a purpose. And so God answers prayers. The Lord answered, He said, take some of the leaders with you and go ahead of the rest of the people and take along the walking stick you used to strike the Nile River. And when you get to the rock at Mount Sinai, I will be there. I like those words that God says. I will be there. Strike the rock with your stick and the water will pour out for the people to drink. And Moses did this while the leaders watched. God provided life-giving water to the people. That's what the picture shows, doesn't it? I can imagine. Imagine this water just kind of flowing out, gushing out of this rock, this crevice that's in there. Giving the people water to drink. All because Moses did what God asked him to do in that moment. God said, I will be there with you. These people aren't going to stone you. These people aren't going to continue to complain to you. These people, well, they will. These people aren't going to harm you in any way. Just do what I say. And he did. And life-giving water poured from those rocks. In that moment, God provided what the people needed. It hydrated them. It gave them energy. It cooled their bodies from the heat. But it also showed to them that God is still active in their lives and is there to go with them as they traverse into this region that they're going. Now we realize that toward the end of that particular lesson, he does say that the people, he had to name the place grumbling and complaining, because they did ask if God, if the Lord was among us or not. But maybe sometimes we even ask that same question, is the Lord among us or not? And He is, isn't He? In good times and bad times. Here was a bad time for the people. They were thirsty. They didn't know where to get this water from. They complained to Moses, and God provided what Moses asked. So again, we read those words from the gospel that says, if you are thirsty, come to me and drink. Have faith in me, and you will have life-giving water flowing from deep inside of you, just as the scriptures say. It's not this water that Jesus is talking about. This water is good and cool. It's in this nice, cozy little thermal mug, and it is still cold. And it's refreshing. And it quenches a parched thirst. But there's a different thirst that Jesus is talking about. It's that thirst for love, for mercy, for grace. It's that thirst for faith and the knowledge of knowing that God is with us wherever we go. And it's not just for us, but it's for anyone who wants that life-giving water flowing deep inside. Have faith in me, Jesus says. In our story that we saw previously, there was a tremendous lack of faith, wasn't it? From the people, and I would say even from Moses for a moment. And we're going to have those same moments, aren't we? We're going to have those same moments where we say, is the Lord among us or not? Where is my faith today? I don't understand. Where is God in the midst of all of this? But God is there. And God offers that water for each of us if we just have faith. If you are thirsty, if you're wanting to know what does God have for you, where does God want you to go, what is it God wants you to do? Who is it that God wants you to share the story of faith with? I have a struggle in my life. I'm struggling with this. I'm struggling with that. I don't have understanding of what it means to do this, to do that. I don't know why God does these things. If you are thirsty, Scripture says, Jesus says, come to me and drink. Have faith in Him. If you want those answers, if you want to know, that life-giving water will flow from deep within you, and then you can do what God has called you to do. It's a fountain of blessings that God offers. And you too become that fountain of blessing for others. That water, that life-giving water can flow forth from you, so that others might find their way to knowing who Jesus is and how He might flow deep within them, and that their faith too might continue to grow. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time. Blessings. Let us sing our closing hymn.
Thank you.
We offer you these words of the benediction. Go in peace. And may the Lord who gave water to his people in the wilderness pour out upon you the fullness of his blessings. May your faith be grounded upon the rock which cannot be moved. And your love be as bountiful as the love which sustains you each and every day. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy One.